Hello, world. Welcome again to the 39.6 live show. This is episode number 32. Can I do a 1031 for a syndication? All right. Thanks again, everybody, for joining us. And I'm glad we got this show relaunched again this week. It's been a blast. And I've been figuring out how things work all over again. There have been a lot of updates of different software. And I think I'm settling into this stuff. Let's tackle today's question. This question comes from one of our members in our Facebook group named Anil. His question is, actually, rewinding, if you haven't joined our Facebook group yet, it's the 39.6 community on Facebook. I have a goal to hit 500 members by Labor Day. And if I do that, I'll keep doing the show so we can continue to grow and learn as a group. So this question is from Anil. His question is, I am invested in syndications and real estate funds. When one of my syndications gets sold and I get my capital and profits back, can I roll them into another syndication, like doing a 1031 exchange? Or do I have to take the profit and pay the taxes? Okay, so this is a great question and a question I get asked quite often. This is really a something that a lot of us want. I am invested in a number of syndications. I think we're in like 11 now. And it would be fantastic if we could just roll a syndication over into another deal and not pay any tax. Okay. That would be fantastic. Just like if you own your own property, sold it, and then bought another property going through the 1031 exchange process. So you don't have to pay capital gains. It doesn't quite work that easily in a syndication. Okay, so you have to first think about the structure of how a property is held when a larger property, like in a syndication investment, is usually done. So usually in a syndicated apartment invested or multifamily investment, you're buying a large complex with, let's say, 200 doors. Okay, and actually just for people who are out there, if you can hear or see me, please let me know just to make sure that everything is working. Okay. But when you own a multifamily property inside an entity like an LLC, that LLC has members. But that one LLC is usually owning the entire asset directly. Okay, so if you looked at the county documents for the sale of that property, it would say that Company A LLC is the single owner, for example, of that property. Now, Company A may have multiple companies underneath it. Okay, it could have Company B, which could be the general partner company, and it could have Company C, which could be the limited partners. And then inside of each of those two companies, so Company B could have, let's say, three different people who are the general partners, and Company C could have all of the other passive investors, okay? And each of those companies would be its own specific entity. So you as an investor, you only own, you have an interest in that Company C, the limited partner company. You don't have an interest in the actual asset itself. You have an interest in an entity which has an interest in a different entity which then has the asset, okay? Or there might not be three entities. It could just be one entity and everybody's underneath that as a member with different kinds of classes of shares. Now, being that as it is, when a 1031 exchange is done, it is most readily done when the same entity is selling something and then buying something. Okay, so you at the bottom are just a member. So if everybody in that entity, okay, every single member stays in that LLC and that LLC basically all sells and then rebuys a new one, that would be very similar to just one person selling a single family rental and then buying a new single family rental within the allotted period of time. Okay, so if everybody is on board, that is one way that a syndication can do a 1031 exchange. Okay, it really works when all of those members agree to do this, because the LLC has all the tax documents that basically would say this LLC sold this and bought this, and it has to spit out a K-1 to all the members each year. Okay, and so that would then get divided amongst all the people. And if it's isolating and protecting all those capital gains from being realized as at the entity level, then that would get passed on to all of the members. Okay. Now, I'm not a tax attorney. I'm not an accountant, a CPA, or I have any formal training in this. This is just from my understanding. So it could all be wrong. But the only way that I have heard of a syndication potentially doing a 1031 is to have every member on board to do it at the entity level. Okay, so it is important, if that is something that you're considering, that you're are very important to you, that you invest with other people who also have that goal, that desire to roll over into the next entity. Okay. However, people have different goals and people's minds change over time. Like 5 years from now, a property could sell and some people may say, I want out, I want my capital back. Okay. So that can make it a lot more complicated. So there you have it. It's not an easy thing to do. If you have a syndication with fewer people, this is a lot easier. Okay. Like if you have a small syndication with like 10 people, okay, and you have 10 people who are all, for example, the same age or points in their career, their kids are the same age, you all have basically the same goals, it's easier to do that. Or having just a small partnership of just a few people is a very good way to do this. So if you are able to put in bigger piles of capital, so instead of like 50,000, but if you can chunk $500,000 and you have, let's say, four people together, put in $2 million together, and you buy a $6 million property, okay, then you have a very small group. And it's a lot easier to have people on board over the long term if you have fewer people in the party. Now, there's also something called like a tenants in common structure of properties. And this is a way that I have seen people do 1031 exchanges. Because for example, when a property is owned, it's routinely owned by just that one entity, but it can also be owned in a separate way called tenants in common, where you have different owners that are not grouped together as an LLC. They're individual owners who each own a portion of that entity, and your own portion, potentially, you could 1031 that. I have seen people, for example, who had an appreciated property and then liquidated it and wanted to 1031 into a syndication. Okay, so a syndication, let's say they were trying to raise $2 million, and this person was going to have $1 million available from the appreciated asset, and they want to roll $1 million, but they don't want to buy $1 million property on their own. They want to roll that $1 million into a syndication. If that person does a 1031 exchange, they can't become part of that syndicated LLC. They have to go in as a separate owner of that property inside of a tenants in common structure. And then the other half of the ownership, the other tenant in common, would be the syndication. Okay, so they lie side by side next to each other in the ownership of that. Okay, and then when that sells, okay, they have two different pieces. Potentially, you could 1031 that slice again. Okay, now this is something I've never done. I've only heard about people doing it. So again, not an expert, but there are other ways to structure some things, but in general, a syndicated apartment investment is very hard to do a 1031 exchange on unless everybody is on board. Okay. Now, if you're talking about a fund, this is a very different situation. Okay. A fund, like a, we call a blind fund, where people invest money into a fund of a company who is doing these types of deals routinely. And they're trying to raise, let's say, $20 million. And then they plan to acquire $60 million of assets. And this could be like five different assets. Okay. Now, you're investing in a fund, and that fund company is going to be buying multiple different assets in there, and they can basically do anything they want to. Okay. And so inside of that fund, you're one step further removed than you are in a syndication where you directly own that asset. Okay. So that fund can really pretty much do whatever they want to do. Potentially, if they wanted to 1031 a property inside there, that could potentially be done, because it might be just that one entity that owns one of those buildings. They sell that building and then roll that into another. But most funds that I hear about, they open, they raise the capital over time, they buy assets, or they might have multiple rounds of funding and they build up, but then they kind of close that fund down as properties get liquidated. And then they periodically create a new fund. So often a company might have a fund that they're raising money for this year. Okay. They raise money for it this year, and then they buy assets, and then they close it to enrollment. And then the following year, they raise money for an additional fund. And each fund usually lives at its own separate entity. Okay. Have another question from Vera. In a syndication deal, I often see preferred returns as part of the offering. I came across one that uses the term coupon of X percent. I was told it is effectively synonymous with preferred returns to the limited partner. Is there, in fact, a difference that I should be aware of? I have never heard of that terminology. The term coupon is associated with bonds. Bonds or loans are completely different. Okay. Now, if you are investing as debt, then yeah, you might be getting paid as a coupon. But if you're investing as preferred equity, which means you have equity ownership, that is completely different than being giving them a loan. So a deal can be structured in different ways. If they need money, they can raise money and have people have equity and have ownership. They could have preferred equity, which is ownership, but the preferred equity shareholders have a higher level on the capital stack. They get paid first before the straight equity owners. And then loans and debt get paid before everything else gets paid to the equity owners. So if you own a property, you usually have a mortgage, and you have your mortgage and you have expenses. Those have to get paid first. Now, there could be a second mortgage. So you could have a property where they raise money and they invest, they want it to be debt. So you could have a syndicated fund that will be owning a secondary lien position on that property. And they can say, we are going to pay you a coupon of 8%. They're going to pay you 8% interest on your money. Okay. They may say they're going to hold on to it for 3 years. And then when they liquidate, they'll give you all your capital back plus 8%, or they could say, we're going to pay you 8% every year, however it is. That would be in a debt structure. Then there could be another portion of capital that is raised that is given as equity or preferred equity. And then there could be equity at the very top. So there's different levels, but using the term coupon, I've never seen it used for preferred equity, and I would question why they're using that term, because to me, that's just grammatically incorrect. A preferred rate of return is the amount of distributions that you should be getting back as a percentage of your original investment that is given to you first before any additional cash is distributed to equity holders. Okay. So if a deal is offering an 8% preferred rate of return to all the limited partners, all of the extra cash flow after all of the expenses are paid, you would have to get an 8% return on your money. Okay. That accrues every month, for example. You would have to get paid that first. Then additional capital can get distributed amongst the limited partners and the general partners, who are usually the straight equity holders. And it's usually in some proportion. It could be like 70% goes to the limited partners and 30% goes to the general partners. It could be 80-20, it could be 90-10. There are a lot of different structures out there, and they're often variable based on the market, based on the deal, based on how much the preferred rate of return is. But I would not use that term coupon. Okay. And my third question, I would like to know what your process is for tax planning throughout the year and who you use. What also is your game plan to use up suspended passive losses? This is coming from John. Okay. So the first question is, regarding who I use, I don't actually have any recommendations for people in the tax preparation area myself. So don't have anybody to share. What is my process for tax planning? Okay, so in general, I have an idea of what we're going to make in a given year. And I look at the chart that I've made before showing effective tax rates versus gross income. And I look at what my effective tax rate will be for the year. Okay, so for example, my effective tax rate might be around 30%. Okay, so I look at our pay stubs. I get mine every 2.5 weeks. My wife gets hers every month. And I look at how much is being withheld from each paycheck in terms of the taxable income, and how much tax was withheld, okay? And I keep track of that. And if I'm expecting our effective tax rate to be around 30%, I look to see, was 30% withheld, okay? And if it was below that, then I need to know that I'm probably going to owe more money. And if it's above that, then I know I might be getting money back. Okay, so I have a spreadsheet and I keep track of all of this, and I look at how much has been withheld and how much of my income was taxable at the federal level. If you look at your payslip, there should be a box that says federal taxable income. That's basically your gross wages minus all of the things that are deductible from your federal taxable income. So if you put money into your 401k, that won't count to your federal taxable income. If you look at all the benefits like healthcare insurance, dental insurance, those benefits are pre-tax. This also includes an FSA, HSA. Those are pre-tax. They are not subject to federal taxation. So that amount will not be included in your federal taxable income. Okay. So I basically chart that. I look at it like every few months. And then particularly around like this time of the year, around August, September, I do another check to see where we are cumulatively of all federal taxable income and all federal tax withheld. And I look to see if I'm like at the 30% mark or not. Okay. I also look to see if we are on track to meet what we call the safe harbor rules. Okay. I don't want to give a free loan to the government in general. I'd rather have that capital available to me. I'm not worried about having to quote unquote pay money when I file my taxes. I'd rather have that money liquid and available to access when I need it, if I were to need extra capital in the short term. Okay, so the safe harbor rule is, there's multiple, but I basically look to see, am I going to have withheld 110% of my federal tax liability from the previous year? Okay, so let's pretend in 2019, let's pretend we paid $300,000 in federal income tax. Okay, I don't know how much it was, but I'm going to use a round number. Then I look to see, are we on track this year to have $330,000 withheld? Okay. If we are on track for that, based on how much is getting withheld from our paychecks, then I also know that we are not going to get penalized. Okay. So those are the two main things I do for tax planning in terms of making sure we're either withholding enough or and if I need to withhold more, I can always just kind of pay directly to the IRS, or I can adjust my W-4 on with my employer, and they can just withhold more from every paycheck. The other issue is if we have business income on the side, I do have to account for that. But as long as I meet safe harbor, then I'm not going to get in trouble. For example, last year, our Airbnb made a ton more money than it made in previous years. And there's no tax withholding for that. Okay, so I was prepared that we have under withheld a substantial amount of money from our taxes last year. And so had to pay a big check this year when we at least filed for our extension. We still haven't finalized our return yet. What will I do for all of the passive losses? Well, they're just going to continue building up. And then when a property sells, those passive losses for that property will get reapplied to that property. It'll offset the it'll help offset the recaptured depreciation. And then I will pay the tax on whatever left there is to pay for capital gains, or if there's any depreciation that has not been offset, or recaptured depreciation that was not offset by the loss. Okay. I haven't actually exited any assets. We have a number of assets. I haven't paid a penny in tax on any real estate asset yet, in terms of on the cash flow or capital gains, but we also have not yet liquidated. Okay. So that is it for today for episode number 32. Until tomorrow, have a good one. And please ask a friend to join the 39.6 community on Facebook. All right. Have a good one. I'll talk to y'all tomorrow.